So, welcome to this first panel on VR organized at this festival. I want to mention my name. I'll be the chairman of this panel. We want to discuss about what is VR, how it will be important for cinema, and where it is going, VR. If exists a VR cinema, where we are heading with these machines that you can see one type of camera here in front of you. Today we have some guests. First is Stefnaia Casini, she's a director. I let them to introduce themselves, and also just say who they are. Then Dennison Bertram, video artist, photographer, and this is the enthusiast we can call. Yeah, okay. And then we have Blaž Zafošnik and Anen Kakmetic from VR360. They are from originally from Slovenia, but they had a startup in Seattle about software, a platform for cinematic VR. So I give directly the. You can tell what is VR for you and a little also introduction.
Okay, first thing, I will speak Italian. So, this is my mother language, and I guess presents if I turn my TV. There is some problem for you if you speak Italian? Okay, I apologize. Allora, io vengo dal cinema, quindi sono abituata a scrivere, pensare dal documentario, ovviamente. Sono abituata a scrivere e pensare per quel quadrato che è lo schermo. Siccome sono una sperimentatrice, mi sono subito interessata a questa possibilità di ingannare totalmente i sensi, quindi di mettere lo spettatore in un punto dove fosse lui stesso a sperimentare quello che succedeva, quindi a non suggerire attraverso un inizio e una fine. Ma a fare in modo che fosse lui stesso a diventare attore dell'azione che si svolgeva intorno a lui. Quindi questa è stata la mia prima, la cosa che io ho subito, che mi ha entusiasmato per il VR. Anche se il VR all'inizio, come forse molti dei giovani, o forse erano giovani di voi, è stata un'esperienza gay. Quindi è stata una visione dove in realtà giocavo e tutto quello che succedeva anche nelle cose più interessanti, il disegno più bello, non era così emozionante perché mi metteva sempre questa emozione, che è l'emozione del vincolo verde, quindi era sempre quella l'emozione. Quindi la mia scommessa è stata quella di cercare di capire come questo mezzo, che è ancora bambino, che chiaramente stanno sperimentando, che ha ancora delle problematiche che poi affronteremo e per chi scrive ha una problematica molto, molto sposto ai temi, perché non è un mezzo che ti permette di usare gli artifici tipici del cinema, che sono per esempio il cambio di obiettivo, che sono il primo piano, il campo medio, il campo lungo, che quindi ti suggeriscono velocemente un'attenzione e appunto vuol portare lo spettatore. Quindi ancora un mezzo che si sta dibattendo in questa problematica, però è estremamente affascinante ed è un mezzo che suggerisce una possibilità non solo di raccontare storie, ma di essere utilizzato in tanti campi e poi ne parleremo. Lo accenno solo qui. Uno che mi sta molto a cuore, che sto cercando di capire come usarlo, è la medicina. Nel senso che se tu riesci a capire certe cose come la dislessia, piuttosto che riesci a fare in modo che il tuo soggetto, il tuo viewer, il tuo sperimentatore, colui che si mette queste cose, possa provare delle emozioni, possa provare delle esperienze che in quel caso sono tipiche della sua malattia, tu puoi riuscire a utilizzarla in un altro modo. E questo del porno, fino a ne parliamo. E poi sono tantissimi campi. Poi lascio la parola a loro. Per me è stata una sfida. Ed è stata una sfida di come, e voi lo vedrete nella mia esperienza qui e che vi invito a fare, di come far nascere delle nozioni in forma poetica. Quindi tecnologia e poesia è stata la mia sfida.
Penso sullo suo self and how you
think about it.
So I'm my background is in fashion. I'm a fashion photographer, and I got into VR about 2 years ago with a friend of mine that showed a camera manufacturer based in
Hello.
So originally I'm a fashion photographer as my background, and one of the things that I've been working with my friends now is trying to bring virtual reality and 360 video to the fashion and sort of cultural world. So we're based in Milan, a small startup there, and what we do is we work with brands to try and show them new ways to reach new markets and new digital mediums. So 360 and VR is sort of a medium at the moment, or the medium of the moment, where we are having the opportunity to create for brands new experiences, new platforms for them to communicate with their audience, the type of things that they're selling, or they're building, or they're trying to share. You know, there's a lot of effort going on right now in the journalism world, or in the idea of like trying to transmit empathy through virtual reality. We're a little bit more interested and focused on the idea of how brands or individuals as well can create magical environments or experiences that might replace the future version of what we see as shopping or consumerism for the luxury and fashion segment. Because certainly you can imagine, you know, right now you see fashion shows being recorded in 360 or in VR, but you can imagine in the future not a simple idea, for example, you know, VR boutique, you know, so you can be in the virtual reality space and be in the show store, which is a very literal translation of what currently exists, the regular stores that you have in the VR space. Instead, you can think of a large brand creating a real dream-like experience after which you come out wanting to purchase their product, or you come out feeling somehow a little bit more attached to the brand. You have a sense of being a Chanel girl, or you know, living the, you know, the Gucci lifestyle in a way that you can't necessarily transmit currently, or at least you can't do it in such a large scale. Certainly these brands do create these types of magical experiences for a very select audience during Fashion Week or special Couture Week events, where they can create these sort of magical experiences for a very small number of people. But it's really potentially interesting if you can create really deeply immersive and deeply moving experiences that you can then transmit to a really large number of people who then somehow can translate into sales. So it's a little bit more of a commercial, productive aspect of it. You know, with the idea that creativity is important, because creativity is what's going to build these worlds in their realism. It's not going to be enough to just be technologically based. You're going to have to create some sort of sense of emotion, creativity, and these types of things.
So my name is Blaž. I'm originally from Sali, from Slovenia. We founded our startup in 2015, and last year we moved the company to Seattle, where we participated in my last accelerator. Development is still based in Slovenia because of lower labor costs, but the company's business development, the sales marketing is now in Seattle. So what we are developing a platform for cinematic VR. You shoot a 360 video, but that's not VR, it's not interactive. What we enable you is you upload the content you shot and you make it into a story. So you can add interactive elements, you make a whole story, and then we help you distribute it to various platforms, from computers, tablets, mobile phones, and other VR devices, so any device that has a web browser. And in the end, we enable you to analyze how the content you created was consumed. So what people were watching, how many times, from which audience, and so on. So that's basically the platform part. And we help financing the development with the sales of our approved Google Cardboards. We, I think, resolved major issues with the cardboards. For example, the volume, if you buy pre-assembled cardboard, it takes a lot of volume and the shipping is very, very expensive with it because the carriers are charging for the volume, not the weight. And also one big problem is double vision, because we have, first we have different delivery distance, and apps have different distances between the center of both pictures for the left and the right eye, so we have adjustable IPF. We also resolve some other issues with the cardboard. So this is how we finance the development. Recently, we closed our first. We are in the process of closing our first seed round with investors from Seattle, mainly former or current Microsoft employees, because Microsoft is based near Seattle. So that's in short everything about our company.
A good comment to your answer, because we talk about VR, immersive video, a lot of stuff. So can we divide in small elements? So what is VR and what is immersive video? Start Blaž.
So yeah, immersive video is basically 360 video. Virtual reality is usually based on CGI, computer generated animation, so that's a game. That's made from different video models, and today the most common engine to run those applications is Unity or maybe Unreal. You can also create virtual reality based on 360 videos. We also call it cinematic VR, but it needs to have interactivity built into it. So you're not only in the middle of the room and watching what's happening, you're not in a passive role. You can influence what's happening, you can transition, or you can do certain things. So that's, I think, it. That there's also augmented reality, I think, that would be probably the next question, and then the mix of augmented and virtual reality, which is called mixed reality, or augmented virtuality.
Dennison, you use mostly video, immersive video, than virtual reality. How do you feel this difference?
Well, I think at the moment with I would say, maybe we should call them all type of virtual technologies, there's a big difference between the virtual reality, or what people like to define as virtual reality, and immersive video. So this is kind of like contentious discussion. A lot of people tend to feel that, you know, to be virtual reality, you need something that's stereoscopic, you need the ability to walk around or move around and interact with space. And online and on forums, there was a really good response to that argument, which is, you know, some guy theoretically has an uncle that comes back from war, he's paralyzed, and he only has sight in one eye, and he tells him, "Oh, sorry, you're not living in reality anymore, you can't move around and you don't see the stereo." So a part of the idea, I think, that goes behind that is what you want it to be. In some ways, it's marketing buzz. You know, it depends on what's cool and what sort of like sells right now and what people want to hear. Because certainly, you know, when film first came out, it was far more real than paintings were. You know, people's creativity and their imagination in the theater made up for the fact that people were actually in our space and actually were Jedi's, or, you know, in these movies, creativity filled in, the imagination filled in the difference. On a technical level, I think, you know, most of the distinction is a technological one. So immersive video is filming in 360 or in 360 stereoscopic, and of course now we have coming filming in 360 light field, which is a little bit more sort of a step, again, in a new direction. But I think the best way to probably put it is in filming 360 video or 360 immersive video, however you want to call it. It's more about capturing some place as it currently is. Perhaps we can add CGI elements to it, or we can, you know, edit it, or we can do whatever with it, but it's based upon something that perhaps already really exists, rather than the concept of, you know, of generative virtual reality, where we're using computers to create the environment that it is more like a game engine. Of course, at some point in the future, when computers are powerful enough, the difference will be trivial. You won't be able to necessarily see the difference, or at least the difference between the real world and a world that's entirely generated. But that's 2017. You know, we have limitations in what we can do. So right now, I think the difference is more of a technological limitation than anything. Certainly, you can do videos, 360 videos at resolutions far higher than any device can actually play back. And you know, whether or not that adds to the experience, because when you do have an opportunity to see really, really, really high resolution 360 video, it's a very different feeling than when Samsung here, VR, or something like that, to experience. But at the same time, it's also a question of how much our storytelling can involve the audience in the experience. Because certainly, if you have a, you know, you have a sort of virtual reality experience where you're, you know, maybe it's like a type of Quake or a Wolfenstein 3D type of experience, if it's a video and it's unclear what happens, you know, you should show up in the, you know, the dungeon of, you know, the castle. But you have to make everything happen, which for many viewers, I think currently, they're not particularly interested in making the movie happen. I mean, we talk a lot about interactivity in virtual reality film, but if you could imagine a movie like, I don't know, Shawshank Redemption, 90,000 VR, and you just turn it on and you're just in a jail cell. Yeah. All right, well, now you have to make the movie. You have to get out and not be executed, and you have to, like, live in the prison. And the movie, of course, takes place over the course of, you know, months. And there's some storytelling that you're not going to be able to use. I'm not going to say, okay, here's your experience of escaping from a prison camp. It takes you 3 years, go. You know, so there's the aspect that we're going to always need, which is somehow we have to give guidance in the storytelling so that the imagination of the person who is experiencing it can fill in all the creative, technological, and other holes that we'll naturally have in the experience, because regardless, we're not going to be able to transmit, you know, everything by VR. Some stories aren't going to work, and there'll be new stories that we haven't even thought of yet that will apply for all the movies.
Una cosa, nel tuo lavoro invece cosa hai utilizzato? L'immersivo integrato a un ambiente di realtà virtuale, solo realtà virtuale con immagini di sintesi, e come hai approcciato questo tuo lavoro, cioè, dal punto di vista proprio tecnico?
Dal punto di vista tecnico, allora, innanzitutto quando uno decide di fare un'esperienza qua, approccia al lavoro in maniera diversa di quando uno fa il regista con un, diciamo, mezzo tradizionale. Quindi diventa parte creativa anche il coder, cioè colui che fa il programmatore, che decide, che lavora attraverso delle formule per riprodurre quello che tu vuoi. Diventa creativo il digital designer, perché l'ambiente che tu vuoi deve essere di un certo tipo e tu devi comunicare con un'equipe, ed è un'equipe che diventa creativa per arrivare a quello che l'ideatore ha voluto. Quindi già un approccio diverso, proprio di lavoro, completamente diverso. Quando io faccio un documentario o un film, decido, scrivo insieme a qualcuno, dopodiché ti approcci con il direttore della fotografia, con il scenografo, con gli attori, eccetera, eccetera, e fai il film che tu hai voluto dall'inizio alla fine. Il processo creativo col VR non è esattamente così, perché intervengono tante cose. In questo caso ho lavorato in maniera molto semplice, perché non mi interessava diventare troppo interattivo, perché io volevo creare un'emozione e quindi volevo semplicemente, con un mezzo abbastanza semplice, avevo lavorato in Unity appunto, in cui l'unica interazione poteva essere quella che più tu fai questa esperienza, l'esperienza non è mai uguale, perché dipende da dove tu guarderai questi oggetti, come questi oggetti ritorneranno. Quindi non c'è una grande interattività, non mi interessava questo, mi interessava stimolare un'esperienza che generasse un'emozione. Quindi diciamo che mi sono più curata di come generare questa emozione attraverso delle immagini di sintesi, quindi delle immagini che già non sono reali, e quindi è ancora più difficile, perché a volte se ti metto un bambino in braccio che piange veramente, o se ti metto un bambino che piange, non un bambino in braccio che piange, sono due cose diverse, non c'è il bambino disegnato, quindi state tranquilli quando lo fate. Però ho dovuto lavorare di sintesi cerebrale. Quindi è vero quello che diceva il nostro compagno di questo panel, che non tutte le storie sono adatte alla realtà virtuale. Quindi non è che tu prendi la cameretta, te la metti lì e poi giri una storia. Puoi fare in modo che qualcuno che lo veda si trova in un posto dove non potrebbe mai essere. E questo è interessante, no? È innovativo. Qui stiamo parlando anche di interazione, quindi addirittura di come variare la storia, come succede in alcune game, no? Io credo che siamo ancora molto agli inizi. Il mio prossimo progetto ha bisogno di questa interattività, pur essendo un progetto che voglio girare in live action, cioè con degli attori. Però io avrò bisogno di questa interattività. Quindi stiamo lavorando, studiando, cercando di capire com'è possibile mettere insieme le due cose, mantenendo quello che è una storia, e quindi dove la tecnologia non può essere così prevalente. È come quando voi vedete un film con una bellissima fotografia e poi dite, sì vabbè, la fotografia è bella, ma poi la storia dove va? Alla base di tutto c'è la storia, quindi secondo me non c'è la tecnologia quasi. Alla base di tutto c'è la storia, è quello che voi volete raccontare, quindi quello che uno vuole far nascere all'interno del mondo emozionale dello spettatore. La prima realtà virtuale è stato il libro. Se voi leggete un romanzo, e se il romanzo è buono, immediatamente voi siete in un mondo che vi siete costruito semplicemente leggendo le parole. Ma quella è l'abilità dello storytelling, quella è la magia del raccontare una storia. E io mi indirizzo nel mio lavoro alla ricerca di quella cosa lì.
Blaž, Stefnaia mentioned interactivity. I know that you recently had a contest on cinematic VR on your website. And how was your experience with the material made by these video makers with the interaction? We're talking about cinema, like linear or interactive cinema, if we can call it cinema.
So yeah, because we wanted to find out people, videographers are creative, and we wanted to find out how our network can be used. So we launched a contest, and we gave prizes winners to attract many videographers, more videographers. So one of the aims of our platform is not to make a linear experience, but to give the viewer an option to go wherever he wants. So either go through that door or that door, or take the red pill or the white pill. So that's this is what we wanted to give to the creators an option to make it interactive and non-linear. So
yeah, how was the result of their work? Do they have issues, have problems with this interactivity? Also from a plot view, like it's not linear, think about all the possibilities. It's like more building a website than a movie.
Maybe. So the technical part is not hard because it's a drag and drop editor. You don't need to know how to code. We say it's zero learning curve because in 1 hour you're a master. The thing about, like you said, the plot is like the storyboard, that's the hardest part because it's now totally different if you come from cinema or if you are a videographer, I don't know, for 20 years, things have changed how, and I don't have a lot of experience with that part, but it certainly changed, and I think that people who, younger people have less trouble with that.
Dennison, yesterday we talked about cinema and 360 video, or VR cinema, is cinema, or is it new language, or what do you think about it?
So naturally we're at a film festival right now, so we cannot say a lot. I personally am of the school of thought that virtual reality, VR, is not cinema. You know, one of the things we've been talking about yesterday was how, so when photography came, we naturally used from the beginning the language of painting to apply it to photography. Saw it in the beginning as a new type of painting. Oh, it's like painting, but it's with a camera. And certainly there were sort of precedents, the camera obscura, which was a method of painting where you sort of like did a little pinhole and then you sort of traced the landscape on the canvas and painted over it. So people saw a natural progression into photography and took the language from painting and applied it to photography in the beginning. So if you look at a lot of early photography, a lot of it replicates the methods of portrait painting of the time. Of course, fast forward, you know, we had 150 years of people experimenting with the medium and really creating, you know, languages with photography. And I would say that today we have a language in photography that is entirely apart from painting. You know, there are things that you photograph that you would never paint or you might not ever be able to paint, not because it's technically impossible, but because the way that you capture and come around to the creativity is different. So in many ways, also with film, you know, when cinema first started, we initially took the experience that we had in theater and applied it directly to the cinema at the same time. But of course now, if you look at, you know, 150 years later, we're no longer just recording a theater play. We're not just going to a local theater and recording that we're doing their play. And actually, if you look at the development of cinema around the world, you can see different sort of, not what we're supposed to say evolutions, but you'll see different ideas as to what filmmaking and cinema really is. So if you look at a lot of like what is done in Hollywood, you see things that are a development of the language of cinema, where we have a lot of close-up shots. You see really tight shots. You very rarely in Hollywood style movies, you very rarely see the entire full body of the subject. You almost always see actors cut in some way, which you don't see them in real life. And in many ways, this enhances your experience of cinema. Cuts that, you know, like, or in quadratures, the framing that we have from cinema is a language that we've developed over time. When you look at other cinemas in other places that are maybe developing on their own or developing at a different pace, if you look at the cinema that's coming out of Nigeria, for example, and a lot of that film is, in a way, the type of language that is coming from the idea of filming theater. So you see the full body almost all the time. In some ways, we kind of feel like maybe it's hokey, or it's not as convincing in terms of acting, but it's actually just a different language in how we're communicating what's happening on the screen. With VR, I think we're arriving at the same thing. The technology seems to us, like it's film, just a lot more of it. But in reality, it's going to be an entirely new medium. You know, something that I get approached with a lot when talking to people about VR is they feel that the art of cinema, the inquadratura, the frame that we have, is a special language that will never be replicated in VR, 360 video. That this is something very special and unique. I counter with that, you know, the language of cinema is that we've constructed so far is actually a reaction to the limits of the frame in the beginning. You know,
because when the cinema starts, the technology is so limited that we can only actually film the world in a little square that's about this big. So we had to construct the language to make that limitation, technological limitation, something that could actually work, because you're seeing very, very tiny pieces. Right? So in the beginning, if you think about it, it's a very limited medium. So now we finally arrived at the technology where we don't have that limitation anymore, but then at the same time, that entire language that we built up throughout the history of film is no longer applicable. It's no longer necessary in that regard, because we created that language as a way to work with the restraints of the medium at the time. So now that we don't have that, all of that language of film, for me, is not really something that's necessarily applicable to VR, because in VR we start to be able to create something that's entirely different. You know, a lot of people like to say that we're at that sort of like Lumiere Brothers type of moment in VR where the train is coming at us and we all sort of freak out. And of course we don't do that anymore, right? You don't go to the cinema and you don't see a spaceship flying at you and you freak out, right? But there was a time when certainly you would have. And VR is in many ways at the same stage. One of the things we had mentioned was how people's brain, in a way, has to adapt to the new medium to understand it. Because the same way that the original people who saw the Lumiere Brothers film with the train didn't understand that this train was not real, which seems crazy to us, right? Like, it seems crazy that you go into a room and someone will show you a picture of a train, and everyone will just freak out, like the train's gonna like run them over, you know? But of course, that's something that's a limitation in our own understanding of the world around us, because we just don't know it. You know, a future where we have small pink elephants walking around on the table might not be something that our future version of ourselves find really amazing. Perhaps even maybe not today. Certainly if we could somehow give you a hologram of a pink elephant on the table right now, you'd be impressed. But you wouldn't have thought it was impossible, right? Like, you're already all prepped to believe that this is a possible thing, you're just waiting for someone to show it to you in one way or another. However, if we'd gone back maybe 50 years, certainly would point. My grandmother, if you had shown her a pink elephant on the table, it's witchcraft. You know, it's a thing that people would not have been able to accept or have been able to handle. So as we go forward in the development of VR, what we're going to do is we're going to find that it diverges more and more from cinema, as we begin to be able to create things that we never really imagined creating with cinema or film. You know, we talk about stories and the story, but maybe in the future we'll have a medium where nobody tells stories. You know, maybe there are just other places that you exist in. So it's sort of like dreams in a sense. You know, certainly you can imagine a future where you could go into dreams and be in them. But we do that all the time already, so in a way we're almost already prepped for that type of experience. We're just waiting for that line. But whether it's going to be cinema, I think, is a different thing, because cinema is the entire body of language that we built up around film. And without that, it's just recording.
It's interesting that the reactions that you can see on the internet, on VR, that the people first put the headset on and had this, they freaks out like in the Lumiere event. I go to Stefnaia, connected to what Dennison said. How was your process from coming from the frame to 360? To imagine and plot or storyboarding of the video or your experience? Because you are a director from traditional media, okay.
In this point, I'm in the process to experiment different way to involve with technology, VR, and my direction, so telling stories. For me, story is the base of everything. I disagree when you think that the new media could be just beyond a dream. We already have done that in cinema. Fellini was one that put you as a viewer in his dream. So I'm experimenting. I'm just like a baby with a new tool, which is not a toy, it's a tool. In this particular experience that I've done it, the problem wasn't the story, as I told you before. The problem was for me to being able, with simple things, to make the viewer in the condition to have an emotion and think about the problem. Think about a reality. This is occurring around us every day. So the reality is migrants. And I was thinking, how can I involve, especially young people? That's why I chose in the beginning the virtual reality as a medium. Because things are going so fast around us, and especially about migrants, you see so many images in the papers and TV, where you see practically always the same image. You see boats sinking, you see people have been rescued, you see faces, you see action, but all of a sudden it's like you don't see anything. It's like when you see too many images of a war, you don't even stop and think about it. It's something that passes, and you don't even want to talk about it. And I had this problem, which was for me an ethical problem. How can I make young people to understand better or to feel an emotion about it? So I pick up a drama that could be a sinking boat. And I thought, I don't want to see people. I don't want to see images that I already saw on television. So let's imagine. If I was underwater, which is an element very interesting for VR, because you are in another environment that you are usually. You are underwater, so you are already in a different conscious. So when you scuba dive or when you go underwater, you have a peaceful image. So I thought, let me put the viewer or the user in a place where it can feel relaxed. So you start underwater. And then I have to give you some emotion. So I worked in this sense and I said, what about I surround him with elements that make this emotion start with a progression. And I thought the thing that really deeply touched me when I was seeing so many, I've done many research on migrants because I wanted to do a documentary 2 years ago, so I've talked with them, I've done many research, and one thing really touched me. When I was in Lampedusa, no, I was in Sicily, but in Lampedusa at that time, and I was walking on the shore, and I saw all this ship rotting. There was the ship of the migrants left over, and I saw a pair of shoes, baby pair of shoes, and this was so strong for me. The memory of this baby that is no more there. The baby was dead on the sea. It was a memory, a touching memory. So this process, I was thinking and thinking and thinking and thinking, and I want to arrive to this point of the emotion the user could have. That's why I call lost memories, because a piece of memory of someone. And then I went to find some migrants. I asked them if they want to participate with some lines they could make, thinking about what happened to them. And so they made the lines related to the object. And I put voices and art in a world that has been done with a computer, so you don't have anything really real. But the emotion you have, I hope if you experiment, but I have already some feedback from other people that they've been experimenting this, and it was in this, right in this sense, there is an emotion passed through. And that's what I wanted to do. I didn't really want to tell you a story. I want you to make up the story through the element I give you, through the emotion I give you. And you make up your own story, and you are touched, and you start thinking of the reality. So it's a different process. The next project, I would love to build a story where, of course, the viewer will be part of the story, will be one of them. So I will experiment something else that I'm very much curious about. The patterns are here in the panel. I'm going to learn something more interesting from you.
Dennison, about shooting in VR, I connect with what Stefania actually said. Is the way you shot, you're a photographer, so you are framed in some way. But when you think about 360, how do you change your mind or your background or your language, visual language?
Yeah, so with 360 filming, you know, we tend to think that a lot of the traditional tools that we have in film aren't available to us, which is actually not true. So we don't have framing in the typical sense where you can do zoom ins or close-ups or just point the camera somewhere. Indeed, in working with clients, one of the most difficult things is they always start by saying, yeah, so first we was like, see this, and you're like, yeah, well, actually see everything all the time, so relevant to see this. You know, so what you have to do is you have to try and construct when you're filming. There's a lot of practical concerns with filming in 360 that are very difficult depending on where you're going to do it. So what you have to do is you have to try and construct your environment or your scene or your story in such a way that you can actually film it in a way that's going to work. You know, one of the things that you sort of need to keep in mind is that you see everything in 360 degrees, both, you know, like that and like that. And you kind of keep in mind how many, you know, what's the term, radians, I guess, how many degrees of your view does an object fill. You know, so something that people tend to do is they say, oh, we'll just put the camera here for fashion shows, for example. Clients say, oh, we'll put the camera here with the rest of the photographers. And when you look at it, you know, if you have the, let's imagine the space right here is the catalog for models and here are the photographers. If you're thinking about it in terms of framing, this actually occupies maybe, I don't know, 8 degrees of the point of view. So when you're actually looking at it afterwards, 8 degrees out of an entire 360-degree field of view is very, very small. So you need to keep in mind how close cameras are to things, because in reality, for many projects, you need to be extremely close. There's a famous photographer, I don't know if it's Person, who used to say, you are the zoom lens, which meant in photography, you know, if you're going to be doing street photography or you're going to be doing documentary photography, don't get a really long lens and try and shoot them from way back here. Just go up to the subject and take the picture. And in 360, that's a really important thing to keep in mind. You really need to get up to your subject, otherwise they simply appear very far away. Because for us, our brains compensate for the fact that maybe I'm looking at you and my brain focuses on you, but really I'm seeing everything all at the same time. And when you lose that ability to focus directly in, you actually do see everything all at the same time. And it's very disorienting in the filmmaking process, because if you just film a room, even this room, we'll look close to this camera, but the rest of you look very far away. So that's, you know, in keeping in mind the type of framing, are framing more by constructing your environment than you are by how you turn your camera. Of course, you have a discussion of how high you put your camera, because normally we walk around, you know, the same height that we are and never think about it. But, you know, people who are shorter than us see the whole world looking a little bit up like this, and people who are taller than us spend their whole life looking a little bit down at the same time. So you also have to construct a type of scene or environment that is a little bit more universal. And in traditional cinema, you never really have to be so concerned about how high, how tall is the viewer of your film, because the language is such that that's a universal experience. But if you're a very short person and you film something from a very high point of view, the resulting experience for people who are very short feels as if you're much too high above the scene, and for people who are very tall, you're much too low in the scene. So this is something that is you also have to keep in mind. You're almost trying to find a balance where most people can watch it and not feel like, oh, I'm too short, or oh, I'm too tall. Because when you're high up, you in 360 video at least, you do have a sensation of being above everything else. And for people who are shorter and not used to being at that height, I certainly have a lot of feedback from people who say, oh, I feel too high. I feel like I'm floating. It's common. It's very common in VR. Whereas on the opposite side, if you put the camera too low or too close to people, you end up having an effect where you're always looking up their nose from the point of view of the viewer. And that's also sometimes very weird. Or it's very unflattering.
It depends also on the story, sorry to interrupt you, because if I want to tell the story of a child, I will use this. Because once again, it depends on the story. It's always depends on the story.
Blaž, we are talking about framing and concentration on parts of the video we are shooting in 360. In your platform, you can add these hotspots. Example with this shooting right now, you can add in the video some hotspots around the scene and interact with it, with all these points. How was your experience based on the material that you received during the contest? How the people was looking at this hotspot? If they look straight, because I think you have all the data about the moving of the VR.
Our platform has different hotspots. For example, the simplest one and most common one is a transition hotspot. So if I gaze to, for example, this door, I look at the door for 3-4 seconds, the transition is triggered, and I go into other physical photo. For example, that's one. Example, the other example is the so-called info hotspot, so I can add photos, videos, or text, whatever I want. I can add actions in the info hotspot. For example, if I'm watching at this camera, I will get additional information, and then at the bottom quote, I will have a link to the website, or maybe I can add it to the basket and go to the online store. So you can do whatever you want with this info hotspot, because it's basically HTML based, so it's quite easy to make different things. So we have also other hotspots like a background audio, spatial audio, for example, so you can hear where the sound is coming from and so on. In our experience, people were using the content during the contest were using hotspots because none of the participants only uploaded one video or a photo. It was basically always a batch of 10 or more different videos and photos that were connected to one storyboard. So I think that's the advantage or one of the main points of the platform. It's not only to shoot one video that's about 60 minutes long, and you are really passive, and you just watch what's happening. You can affect what's happening to you. You can affect where you're going and how the story will evolve. So,
do you see if there is a new method of communication? And people are evolving in a new method of communication with this storytelling also. I think it's a very powerful platform for storytelling, because you have all this stuff around around you.
I'm not sure if I understand the question.
If your platform would be a base of a powerful storytelling, like a storytelling machine.
I think that's our aim. We want our platform to become a new way of telling a story, and especially in journalism. For example, I don't know. In the past, you could all journalists told the story through text, then we had photos, then journalists also could tell a story on the TV or any other medium. But what we want to do is we want to provide a new way how to tell a story. So it's something. The story with the immigrants is very popular nowadays. You can read it's the story from the journalist who was in Syria, but you can do the experience how it was there through immersive video. You can see what's happening there, and you can also sort of move there. You can really experience it with our platform. So I think this is what we want to do.
I was thinking when I was speaking. Yes, for journalists, this is a kind of a very interesting new tool because the journalist needs to explain you many things. So not only the fact what is behind, what is the future, the consequences. So I've seen it that in interactivity. So I've seen many interactive documentaries made by journalists. So this kind of interactivity is very interesting for this kind of things, or for science as well. If I have to explain something scientific, like how the life of bees or something like this, of course, I can put you in a situation where you are the bee, so you are surrounded in cells and you are, but at the same time, I can explain you what that means, what is the percentage of sugar is and the honey or whatever. Or it's very interesting for historical storytelling, because I can give you the fascination and to explain you something that are behind the archives that you see. But the problem is always the emotion. I experimented many of these interactive documentaries, very interesting in the point of view of what you learn. Very few of them give me some emotion. So the problem is always the emotion. What do you want to pass to your story? Do you want to pass to the objective situation and what are the consequences of that? Or you want to make your viewer or your audience feel something, feel an emotion. So these are basically the two important things when you approach the 360 degree video or whatever interactivity. For me, this is the core that you have to proceed in terms of a video maker, as I am. And I've seen it, the artists have the same problem. For the artist, it's not that important that you know. It's important what is your perception of this opera. So I've seen more interesting VR experience made by artists than made by journalists or made by directors in these terms, just because they work in another direction. They work through emotion, they could be mental emotion. Like when we see a Paolo painting, Paolo, it's a mental emotion. Or when you see Renoir, it's a visual and a different emotion, sentimental emotion, memory emotion. So these are really the things that, it's why we are at the beginning. Because we don't really know yet if interactivity is could reach this emotion or not, and the other things which is very important that you were telling about in terms of the director, when you have to write for a VR, you have to be absolutely conscious of the fact that you have the back. And if I, there must be a reason why you're moving my back. Because I'm not a, like a bird who does like this. I look here. So if there is something that in the story is helping me to put my attention behind, and I have to decide it and strategically build the environment. And in fact, if you just take one of the simple cameras, the 360, and you put in a square here in Trieste, you don't have no one in motion. But if you put this little camera and you go in a, like say, Baroque church, and you put it in the middle, you have a completely different emotion because it's so surrounded by object, and all of this object is such a powerful that you feel this power. You feel because you are surrounded by all these objects that are very strong, even if you don't understand what is the meaning of the object. So it's very important, the space, when you came into the city. And what in the space is going on related to the story that you want to tell to your public, to your audience. And sounds is the most important thing. So, for instance, I had a problem, my sound is not really 360 because I didn't have the tools at the moment when I made it. But sounds, must be really 360 because the emotion that you can have through the sounds is incredibly bigger than what you have through your eyes because it is a part of the memory of the emotion of your brain and is stronger. So there are elements we have to think about on the storytelling. And the other things, I'm sorry, I'm being too long. And the things in terms of the actor is the human actor here. Because you have to orchestrate the movement of the people that are in the scene in a certain way and the timing, otherwise there is no sense. You don't have any emotion, you don't have any story, you don't have any action that happens.
May I make a comment on the journalism, 360 journalism? So I don't do 360 journalism. And I actually feel that, there was a great piece by the New York Times they did where they followed a group of refugees and they went through the experience. And it was really beautiful and it was really moving. However, for me personally, I feel that there's a big ethical danger in 360 journalism. It's voyeurism, but it's even more than that. In this piece that the New York Times did, it was really great. It's very moving. You like travel with the refugees. You know, you're in the field with them. Then you're on the truck moving with them. But in a way, it's a kind of lie, right? Because in this video, they don't see the camera. You are this invisible observer there who's watching them. But that in and of itself is not true. Right? Like, in the production of these type of experiences, when we deal with refugees or migrants or people who are in different situations, there is a temptation to say that this is true. And because the medium seems so much more immersive, there's a temptation for us to accept it as more true. But in reality, especially with this documentary with migrants, there was at some point a journalist or a camera person who came in with a camera that said, okay, everybody, this is what's gonna happen. I'm gonna put this camera here. You're gonna like walk this way or run this way. And you're not gonna touch the camera. You're not gonna get too close to the camera. You're not gonna do anything. You're just gonna act natural. Just be a refugee, okay? Record, and then they go hide, and they play refugee, right? And even though maybe that's very callous thing to say, there's an aspect of truth to that, right? If you're truly a migrant, or truly a refugee, or truly someone in a war situation, you don't
walk down the field and see a camera like this and don't think, well, what is that? Right? I mean, it's one of the biggest problems for filming live events in 360 is that people come up and they touch the lens. You know, regularly people go, oh, you know, really close, and we'll get in, people start putting their fingers on the glass. But this is the number one problem dealing in 360 in live events is that people just can't resist coming up and checking it out. Indeed, even wildlife, people who film wildlife with 360 cameras have the same experience. Animals see the cameras and they're like, what? And they come up really close to it. Of course, we'd love to have the animals get really close. But it's disruptive for your 360 migrant refugee story, right? But in and of itself, there's an ethical problem because in some way now it's almost like a teleplay about suffering.
Yeah.
It's a teleplay about whatever these people's experience is. Because someone has to say, okay, everyone, this is what's gonna happen. Here's the camera. You guys be refugees, suffer, but don't touch the camera. Please don't get too close. You know, just like stay away. You know, and in that in of itself, I think we run the risk of two things. One is instead of desensitizing us to the plight of other people, you know, to what happens when you see too many images of war, you know, you're going to die. Fine. You know, instead, you get to come to a point where, instead of actually feeling, oh, this is so terrible, I think in a way not dehumanizes, but it creates a sense, a new type of distance between you and the reality of what's happening for them, right? Because there is this sense of this isn't real or it's hyper real, but either way, it's not true. Right? But we present these sort of 360 documentaries as truth, and they're really not true. And that line of exactly what happened the moment before the camera started recording is going to become more and more important. Because certainly with journalism, with photojournalism, you know, we hold photojournalists to very high standards. You can't edit it, you can't clone it, you can't direct it. But indeed, when you're doing 360 journalism, unless it's entirely live, and even then if it's entirely live, there's an aspect of the fact that because you are there recording, you have in some way changed what is happening there. You know, and this is what I think we have to be very, very careful with. Because in these documentaries that show the experience of people, you do have to create this, okay, everyone, suffer, be refugees. They're unwilling or unexpected actors in your pseudo-journalist realist production. And we as the viewer, we intend to watch them and be like, oh, this is all true because it looks true. But in reality, I mean, it's a very same situation. If you're escaping a war and you come across a camera like this and maybe a journalist hiding underneath it, they're like, just keep going.
Yeah, but once again, I'm sorry, this is a problem of the journalism itself. Because if there is not a journalist point of view, and you pretend to be objective, this is not journalism, this is something else. And so 360 degree video expresses exactly that. I've seen many of these brief things made from Bezzanza Fontier, things like this, where there is Susan Sarandon going and seeing with the baby here, you have 360 degrees or whatever. But the problem is, there is not explanation, there is not a point of view, there is not, if you read a piece of good journalism, just read it, and you really get the feeling of the war or of the privation, because the good journalist is able to pick up a story of someone and tell you the reality to this story and with his point of view. And once again, this is a problem. You are the media, but you don't have you are not able to make the real story with this.
But I think that is the danger. You know, with journalism, you certainly can have a point of view. But I think with virtual reality, you run the risk of hiding the fact that it's my point of view, and instead, people interpreting it as being real. Okay, that's the reality. Really,
challenge for your cinema, if we can call like that. I have one question for Blaž and Alan. We talk about shooting, we talk about writing or imagining for VR. It's also another difference is viewing VR. This is also different than cinema. The cinema you have a screen, but VR you have something different. You can also have a screen with a mouse pointing or a smartphone or some viewers. So how you can view the VR video?
So you mean about which platforms can you use for?
Yeah, whatever. You have a lot of, you can use a desktop or a headset.
Yeah, so music video can be viewed on a normal screen, but that's you're showing three-dimensional space, 360, in 60 degrees on a two-dimensional screen, so it's not a real representation. So you can use your mouse or a tablet gyroscope and you move around, but 360 videos have to be viewed through VR headset. So we have mobile VR, which is the simplest device. It's Google Cardboard. You insert the phone in this, and you can view a video on the YouTube or any other app. You have Gear VR, which is one of the most distributed devices. You have Google Daydream, so those are all mobile VR devices. Then you have high-end devices, which are powered by computers. For example, Oculus Rift is one of the most well-known. It's basically the first real VR device. Was the first VR device. HTC Vive is also one of them, and PlayStation VR, which is add-on for PlayStation, and I think was one actually the is one of the most sold devices in the higher end of the market. So those are basically the devices. How you can view it? I think viewing something in the cinema, you are basically seeing what the author wanted you to see. But viewing a movie in VR is something totally different because here maybe a fight is happening, but I can watch behind there. I can watch a car if I'm interested in the car, so I can every time I see a movie, I will probably see it totally differently, if you understand, because I will always direct my people wherever I want, so yeah.
This is the problem why you have to generate a reason why I turn my head.
Yeah.
But besides this, this is just the funny things to point. It's very peculiar, the aesthetic of the cast. Who's Google now that made this aesthetic like a pashmina? Yes, velvet or something. So, because these things is such a crudely technological, now they start to make it more cozy, more soft, more like an object that you like to have with you and put on it. This is special, it's changing the technology physically.
So actually that's a really interesting point. In September, we produced about 15 360 videos all over Italy, working with artisans for Camera Nazionale della Moda and the MUDEC Museum to present artisans in evolution, like the idea of how artisans in Italy are using technology to go forward with today and using different technologies, etc. But the big problem was we were producing these videos which were supposed to be played at the exhibition. And it was during Fashion Week, so it opened with, a lot of the people in fashion, Sopranos and Zani, American Vogue. And the number one thing that Kamran Natsunala de Lamota said to us with regards to presenting the 360 video was, if it messes up the women's hair, you can't do it. And they said, absolutely, if you mess up people's hair, you can't do it. Got it. You know, because they knew that none of the you know, editors of the magazines or the people who really, you know, especially the women who put a lot of energy and work into coming out for Fashion Week, there was no way that they would ever get them to put on a headset. It doesn't matter how amazing it is inside, they weren't going to do it. So we had to solve this problem by actually building a new type of headset to make it something that wouldn't ruin your hair. You know, because the current thing, you put a strap, and there's like another strap, and there's the cables, and they just look at it. The headphones, and they're like, no, absolutely not. So we actually designed a new type of headset based on the Samsung Gear, where we stripped it all down, and we created a new frame, and we worked with the designer, Stefnaia Casini, who's a very famous luxury accessory designer, does a lot of eyeglasses for Prada and tones and like that. And he revisioned the idea of the headset entirely, and it became, there's pictures on Instagram if anyone's interested later, and it became just this very silvery ball that just sort of sits in front of your face and then hangs down from above. And it was really beautiful, it was very beautiful, but it was something that people would both you put on, didn't ruin your hair, and it was an attractive device because in certainly the fashion world, with our fashion clients, very early on, for example, speaking about the cardboard in a kind of funny way, we went to one luxury brand and we're talking to them, they love the technology and they love the idea and the attractivity in the video, and they're like, okay, so we are a luxury brand and you know, we're showing them Google Cardboard saying, you can buy something out, you can do invitations, email. Everyone's like, great, we love it. And we went to the boss. And they're like, okay, so we're this luxury company, you know, we make bags for 5-10,000 euros each, you know, Italian leather, XYZ, super luxurious, and you want me to give my clients something made from cardboard. And that was the end of the deal. That was it. It was just like, never. I will never give my clients, my customers, something made from cardboard, because that's not who we are. You know, we don't work with cardboard. You know, and that continues to be a major stumbling block in the fashion industry, where you show them the Google Cardboards, or you show them the Samsung Gear, or you show them the HTC Vive, and for them, for the most part, it's technology without a real, without a conceptual point of view. There isn't any design to it, there's no soul to it. It feels to them like technology, which in many ways is the opposite side of the spectrum for fashion, because you know, fashion or you know, the arts is something that's timeless in and of itself, and technology is sort of the fundamental opposite. And if you look at what we have today, in many ways these things look like technology, because also the people who design them are from the background of technology. Right? So when they look at them, they make cameras, you know, okay, for tech people, oh, it's black, it's cool, you know, but for people who you know, are interested in fashion or have like an aesthetic point of view, there's no aesthetic value in that. It looks like what it is. It's a functional object.
But there's a difference in Asia. In China, it's a difference with carrying a headset.
Yeah, so that's another interesting thing. In China, which is one of the larger markets, one of the largest markets we're being on right now, there isn't this problem with the technology. The adoption of technology in the Asian countries is really a lot higher than in Western countries. And for them, the headsets, the technology, this doesn't present a step problem for them. So if it looks crazy, black, technology, lights, whatever, they don't care. It's cool, the adoption rate is really high, so even if you're a brand, you can push this and people accept it. Another thing is that here in the West, although it's unfortunate, we probably think of, we don't think about it very much, but there is a really deep gender divide with technology in the West. So women naturally, here, there is a difficulty in pulling women into technology simply because we have a cultural bias against women in technology. And women themselves don't, certainly with VR, for example, women don't naturally take a headset and put it on for the most part. it is labeled in many ways a gamer, guy type of thing, and we're fighting this gender discrimination that we have in modern society, which you don't actually have actually in Asia, where women and men will both take VR and adopt it equally, and there isn't or at least not to the level that we have here. But for us, it's a big problem, certainly. If you can't get women to put on a really high-end virtual reality headset, then you're only going to be left with a certain segment of the population of men who are using the real high-end hardware. Right? And that speaks a lot to us about what sort of experiences we can create and what sort of experiences we can certainly sell if we know for a fact that, okay, our market is, by and large, male, 25, 45, white, in a certain economic class. You're not going to be able to sell a product to brands that are trying to reach out to women, for example, in fashion. If people in fashion feel like, well, women will never put this on anyway, so who cares?
Okay. Before the Q&A part at the end, last question. What do you think about the future of VR as a medium?
I think in the long run, augmented reality or maybe mixed reality platforms are going to meet in terms of numbers and market sizes. I think VR is something that's going to be used more intimately, in your home, at your house, maybe an airplane. You're going to go to a casino. You don't have a lot of space, but you can go the other places. I think VR is going to be really big in medicine. I read articles about how people get healthier much quicker if they are at the hospital, for 1 month, and you give them an option to go to nice places virtually. They are going to get better much quicker. So I think VR is going to get big. It's a tough market to make money in because there are not a lot of people. There's not a lot of great content at the moment. Everybody's struggling. Content creators are financed by headset manufacturers. HTC is investing, or Oculus is investing. A lot of companies that are making great software for the devices. So it's a hard market because the distribution is not there yet of the devices. The devices are not in the market. We have Google, but we have millions of Google cardboards. But the thing is, people try it. They think it's great when they try the VR for the first time, even though it's the worst experience we have in VR. But they then put it on the shelf and they don't use it anymore. And we also have a problem with our platform. It's main want our platform, the content created with the platform, to be consumed with a virtual reality headset. But in reality, people rather use computer and rather with mouse or they use a mobile phone with gyroscope. They don't see a big benefit of using it in the VR mode. So it's a market that's really growing fast. I have read somewhere that, I didn't read it, I heard it from a camera manufacturer that the number of 360 videos on YouTube practically doubles every month. So the market is really, really growing very fast, but it's, like I said, it's a hard market. The porn industry is probably the most profitable at the moment. It's something that's not, people don't talk about it, but I think in a few years, VR was is probably 50 years old technology, and we had ups and downs. I think now it really is the time because hardware is there, it's getting better every year, and the experiences are going to be really, really better every year. So I think it's not going down again, but in 3 years it's going to be totally different because of the distribution of the hardware is going to be, we will have millions of really good devices out there, and this will attract content creators into the market, and they are going to be able to make money in the market. So, that's it.
That's the same question, but I add something today. This morning I read that as the first nomination at the Academy Award of cartoon, PR cartoon.
Oh, yeah.
Her. So, so the future also in cinema, how it will be done, PR.
So first of all, if you haven't seen the 360 film by Google Labs called Pearl, you should. Even thinking about it, kind of makes me like, wow, it's really, 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 really good. And it sort of arrives to that point of where you go, okay, this really will work if you do it right. And then a few other videos that you think, this is what it's going to be. I think going forward, it's important to understand what AR, augmented reality, is going to do to the market, because we tend to think about them as the same, because the technology kind of looks on the surface the same. But you know, going forward with augmented reality, where we sort of overlay digital things in the real world, the true revolution is probably going to be in the augmented reality world. But not because we'll be able to tell better stories, but simply the idea is that with augmented reality, we can finally replace all the devices that we potentially might have. You know, the future office is wherever you want it. You know, your screen is always as big as you can possibly handle. You know, your phone is always wherever you want it. You know your green, pink elephants that follow you around. You know, they keep you company. So the idea that we layer on and somehow augment the world that already exists is a very powerful idea, and certainly will be the future. On the flip side of it, it's going to be massively more difficult, because what it requires is computers that are not just powerful, but actually simultaneously understand the world around us the way we understand it. So it requires a lot of processing, where your pink elephant understands it's on a table, so it can't walk off the edge of it, for example. Because that certainly would break the illusion if your elephant walks off the table and just keeps walking off in a distance. Right? So there you go, that's flipping around. So that is going to be a bit farther still in the future, because of the massive amount of sort of artificial intelligence actually that's going to be required to drive this sort of experience. 360 video, however, is also going to continue. Certainly now, whenever I watch a live broadcast or I look at a picture or something like that, I'm tempted to try and move it around and see another point of view. And certainly people that I know who work a lot in the 360 space have the same type of experience. On Facebook, the ability just to move your phone like this or swipe a little bit is, although for us, I think, it's a little bit of a disappointment, because we'd like to see everybody in these like ultra super futuristic helmets. The reality is most people are really happy just using it on their phone, scrolling. They don't need stereoscopic. They don't particularly like interactivity, because it makes a little bit too much of a demand on them. But they really do like the moving it around, going like this. They're very happy with it. These videos get an enormous amount of views on Facebook. You can track people's usage. They watch them longer than regular videos. They share them more often than regular videos. So this is a successful new medium. Perhaps it doesn't fit our utopian idea of what virtual reality or 360 could or should be, but in some ways it's almost like urban planning, where city designers design a sidewalk that goes around a big square of grass, and then people come out and they just walk straight across it, and after years you understand that it doesn't matter what you can do. The people, the cows, everyone just walks straight across it, and that's where the sidewalk should have always been. We love it to be in a perfect square because it looks nice and it fits our idea of like how people are going to be. But in reality, once we put it out there, they're going to simply, people will just consume it the way they want to consume it. I mean, I have these high technology helmets, and to be honest, I enjoy it more on Facebook, where I can do it a little bit. It's great. And if I can add one note to that, I recently picked up a pair of the Snapchat Spectacles, which
image when they come out, you should definitely get it. The only downside, I think, with the spectacles is you have to be on Snapchat, which I think I'm outside of the age group already, but maybe it's talking again, to be honest. However, you know, something that happens with Snapchat spectacles, which is sort of a bridge to the augmented reality experience, in that it's getting people comfortable with the idea of wearing the computers on their face, which is an enormous thing. I mean, I have a video on my Facebook that I did during Fashion Week, where we're backstage and we're with the teacher guy. And she comes up and she's looking at the glasses and I'm recording, and she's like, "What are these glasses?" And I was like, "Oh, you need these new Snapchat spectacles." And you could see in her mind, because I mean, she's such a creative woman, you could see in her mind that she's like, yeah. And when I explained to her that to record a video, she's like, "Oh." But in the fashion world, that's the first piece of technology. If you'd gone backstage wearing Google Glass, people would be like, "Oh yeah, him, he's definitely not Glass." That guy with the Google Glass, no way. But you go in with Snapchat spectacles, and the designer's like, "Oh wow, that's cool. Oh, this is really nice. Oh, you know." So we're making that transition to, we can stick the technology on your face, and people are going to think it's cool, and people are going to accept it. You know, right now, just this video, but in the future, of course, all those weird filters that you have in Snapchat that people love, they'll be able to add that, superimpose that directly on top, you know, so you can imagine an augmented reality where everyone in the room are big dogs, you know, and they're always with their tongue out and have, like, birds flying around their head. It sounds crazy, but, you know, that's, I swear, that's probably, like, next year, you know, where you can do that. And people will love that experience, you know, especially young people will love that experience, making everyone look ridiculous all the time. And in addition to that, from the filming point of view, is a final thing. With the Snapchat glasses, when you're filming, you're not using your hands, which is obvious. But it's very interesting for your own, certainly you see first-person point of view videos now and then, different things. But it's very interesting when you're doing your own personal video and you see both of your hands, which sounds like a very strange thing. It doesn't seem like a big difference. But suddenly you're doing this all the time. And in your videos, if for me personally, maybe for other people they get a little experience, but for me it's fantastic. It feels particularly cool that I'm both recording and seeing my hands at the same time, which sounds very simple, simplistic, but if you think about it, an intrinsic aspect to you filming anything is that you can never see both of your hands, right? Like, we accept that as normal. If you're the camera person, if you're filming, you cannot be 100% active with your hands inside of whatever. Right? You can't film yourself, you know, you can't manually film yourself and roll a pizza dough at the same time.
It's not 360.
Well, except for 360, but you can't hold it. You know, this is like a bridge, right? You can't film yourself driving, or you shouldn't film yourself driving. And drive at the same time. You know, you can't say, "Hey, look at that, that's cool, and all this," and film it and drive at the same time. Right? So this is a new type of mini language. I mean, I think we'll see a lot of young people who are gonna do, you know, teenagers with unlimited amounts of time. You know, they're going to do really amazing things when they get their hands on these, because it's going to be a new mini type of language where they can film make and be 100% participant in the film at the same time. You know, and that's, you know, a little small thing, but it's a similar idea with the 360. We have these limitations that we naturally just assume, of course I'm never going to see my other hand, I have to hold the camera. You know, but, you know, imagine being a journalist, a film journalist, and being able to take a picture of the baby on the street while also picking up the baby. Photojournalist, you know, you can't because you're holding a machine. You're holding your tools that you're doing your job with. But so the idea that maybe you can somehow transmit or change the experience is very interesting. Because also, it also solves a little bit the framing problem or point of view. Because everyone who watches the video is always watching it directly from your point of view. So everyone who sees the video is always seeing it exactly how you saw it at that time. Which is also very perspective, because in 360, of course, no one sees it from that perspective. So it's sort of a meta stream into augmented reality, sort of a stepping stone that we'll have to go through before people are comfortable with fancy technology and always on camera. This sort of direction.
Real world to view? Is that just the
My partner is the audience. The exteriority for now is something that you consume alone. There is a big difference when you go to see a movie in a movie theater and when you see alone on TV or with some friends on TV. The timer of the attention that you pay is different. And the empathy with the public is very important in a movie. If it's a dramatic movie, there is a kind of emotion, dramatic emotion. And this empathy, you feel it. Imagine a thriller when you see alone, when you see with some other people, someone is screaming, and you get this tension, or a comedy, where there is somebody laughing, a point, and this laughing is completely empathetic with you, and even you laugh, maybe you don't think to laugh at that point, but it's something that... So, I have to dream that this technology would be like a movie theater where the screen is 360 degrees, and we can all be in the center, and you know, and understand the feeling of the other people. Because for me, as a filmmaker, the audience is essential. And the limitation in this case with 360 is that you are alone. And you don't feel that you have a contact with the other people that see the same things, but in a different way. So for me, this is the limitation. So my dream is a room, a round room, where can be together and participate. So it's more like a theater if you want. It's like when the theater came from stage and put the audience at the center of an action that was around in the 60s. The same idea.
There are already some techniques on sound.
Yeah, more time.
So, if you have some questions, you can give us to answer.
Is there any business model in place at the moment? I mean, are you making money on virtual reality production, or is it just technology-driven business, you know, companies investing into it and selling devices?
I think there are companies that are making they're shooting 360 videos, and there's a viral company in Seattle that does a lot of work for Microsoft. There are a lot of companies that are making. I think that the content creators, in terms of apps and developing apps, I don't know, that are published in App Store or that are sold, I don't know, for HTC Vive or other platforms, it's hard for them to make money because there are not a lot of people that can already buy this content. That's the problem. But the service companies can make money, I think. So the companies that are giving custom apps for marketing agencies or for that are shooting music videos, those can make money because there's not a lot of competition. You know exactly, you write a contract, you know what the contract value is, and you know what your costs are, and that's much easier. But if you make a game and you need 200,000 sold copies, that is really hard.
Are there any numbers available, you know, about the market and, you know?
They say that the VR and AR market is going to be 160 billion market in 2021. VR is going to probably 20 to 30 billion dollar market at the moment. At the moment, I think it's the most of the market is the hardware. I think it's already bigger than 1 billion, but mostly it's hardware, then it's the games, the game industry, and so on. And
the market we are talking about is only 50% of the total.
Do you feel that it's like a gimmick? We are like we saw some iteration, for an example, in 3D already existing, and so on. Also also apologies for my English and for.
Would it maybe be easier if you add the question in Italian and?
Sono un po' emozionato per questo. Cioè sì, come se fosse appunto una specie di moda del momento. E se appunto.
Yeah, absolutely. But that doesn't mean that it's not.
No, I mean if you see like it's not anymore at this time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's over. Like 3D was a hype, and
right.
Like the market just went like that.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you mentioned like 3D, right? Because you know the first really big boom of 3D was those, you know, like Victorian nude pictures in Paris in like the 1800s, right? So it's a gimmick, but it's lasting a long time. Mm-hmm. Certainly now the market has grown, although who knows how many they sold back then.
Mm-hmm.
From a technology point of view, it's a gimmick only in that we don't yet really know what to do with it. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's all sort of toys, but we don't understand yet what to do with them. You know, the automobile was a gimmick in the beginning. People thought, oh, it's stupid, you need oil in it.
Yeah. Yes, maybe gimmick. It wasn't the right term to use in this context. Couldn't fetch a new term more appropriate for.
Oh, so there's a curve, a really famous curve called the hype curve. So when everyone gets really crazy about something, and then it sort of goes down, dies down for a while. I certainly think we're entering a somewhat quieter period for VR. Because we don't yet have the technology, but we don't yet necessarily have enough content. But it's something that I think we are all growing into. Certainly, I think if any of you out here has a modern smartphone, you'll probably be able to film 360 video within a year or 2 years. You'll probably be doing it yourself as well. So I think over time, for me, it seems inevitable. We could, of course, be wrong, but it. You know, there's never really been a new medium that was created and then it really entirely went away in one way or another. We're always just sort of waiting for the part of time.
Yeah, and I think another thing, I see more and more artists interested in this kind of medium. And when the artists are interested, they always open a new street. So it's very, I haven't seen so many artists in 3D, but I see because also the technology is easier and more affordable. So you can experiment. Of course, you cannot make a billion movie or whatever because then you need a lot of money, but the technological tools are quite affordable. So and the artists are, especially young artists, are very much interesting on that. And so they start to think and create it. So this is a street that's going to be open.
So yeah, for example, I've heard many point of views from you guys. Really, really interesting. To me, there is like a big issue about VR. I'm a VR filmmaker, been working for the past year. It's something, and when I put on the globe of the Samsung gear, it feels strange to me because it's something big, heavy, and it stays there. And you mentioned about new designs and new kind of devices to overcome this difficulty, which for me is primarily because it's still something uncomfortable. And it reminds me when, well, it's something similar to me to the stereo cinema 3D and watch with the glasses. And to me, it's still uncomfortable. I mean, it never took off because of that reason, I think, because it's beautiful to see that depth of field in the images, so to perceive that field between the actors, the foreground and the background. But still, to me, it was a main issue about having to wear a device that then you had to experience the scene. And this is one of the moments of the VR, and even more extreme. And the devices that I've seen so far, aside from the blaster that you mentioned, the one which also caught. They have this main issue, and I'm intrigued on how the technology will develop in this sense.
Our main investor was, if you know, Microsoft HoloLens. He was architect of that device, and he is now our COO, Chief Operations Officer. He recently retired, and he joined that team. He told us that first Microsoft HoloLens was a big machine, and you only put one part on your head, and then they had like six iterations, and now it's still probably the biggest device out there. But it's much, much smaller, and I think if I compare it to our smartphones, nowadays smartphone is more powerful than computers a few years ago, but it's so much smaller than first mobile phones, which were like a briefcase. So I think if we look in the past, technology has always overcome many problems. People once were taught in schools that sound cannot be digitalized, but nowadays practically we don't have analog sound anymore. So I think it should be a problem. In terms of physics, devices are going to become lighter, but not necessarily much smaller, because the distance between the lenses, the focal distances, and this stuff, this is physics. And I think this cannot be solved, but the devices are going to become more comfortable. And in 3D, I was in LA, at VRLA conference, and I saw a big screen there, 3D, and it worked perfectly, and you didn't have to wear the goggles, so it really worked well. When you saw a baseball coming at you, I was really scared because I thought it's going to hit me. So also, I think 3D is not that yet.
You know, something else to keep in mind is when we talk about things like the industry will be $100 billion industry by 2023, or you know, it'll be everywhere by 2030, you know, give it 5 years, give it 10 years. In many ways, it's important to keep in mind, even though it's maybe a little bit depressing, it's like the people with the buying power in 10 years are the people who are 7 years old right now. Right? So for them, the idea that this headset is heavy is not relevant to them. You know, the same way that, you know, my mom getting to use Microsoft Word was, you know, Dennison, please come help me with this. I'm trying to save, I'm trying to print, where did it go? It disappeared. It's like, mom, you just click there. Right? And that is something that older generations really took a lot of energy to struggle and to be able to like adapt to just using the interface of using something like this and it corresponding to some sort of action happening on a screen. And certainly we could have had this discussion 40 years ago, people would be like, the mouse was a stupid name, and then it gets off, wants to hold the mouse, it's weird, right? And certainly then what happens is new people grow up with technology and it's normal. I mean, you see my friends with babies, children, I mean, they already know how to like pinch and zoom. You know, it's a crazy idea. You know, you see your children, I mean, there's so many videos on the internet about this. You see babies go to like a magazine cover. They're like trying to make it like Zoom, and you know, then they're just like really disappointed with like printed things. Like, oh God, you know, this sucks. You know, so that we feel, oh, nothing will ever replace paper, man. Like it's, you know, the touch, the smell, the paper. This is great. You know, and, you know, being used already like swiping, right? Which is crazy, but it's going to be that type of progression where when this hits, it's not really for us anymore already. You know, we are in many ways looking out for the crowd. You know, we're too late. You know, certainly we're building it, but it's not for us, right? Like this isn't for us. We're building it, but it's not for us. We were excited about it, it's the future. It's like, you know, sometimes I was just reading the other day, you know, the Czech Republic signed an agreement to build a hyperloop between Prague and Bratislava, so you can like go from Bratislava to Prague in like 30 minutes, and it's amazing. It's gonna take like, you know, 30 years to build, right? It's amazing, it's so impractical right now, it's so expensive, but we're building it anyway, but it's not for us. And in many ways, the VR and the 360 is not for us. We're building the technology, we would like to all be the Lumiere brothers in one way or another. We want to create the great Fellini masterpieces. We would like to, you know, do the same shift from like the writer-based idea of cinema to the auteur theory of cinema. We want to be there for it, but we are not the future. Unless, I mean, maybe someone is out there or somebody crazy and amazing can do it. But the reality is that, you know, there's someone who's five today who is just trying out, you know, cardboard or has an iPhone, and they're already growing up understanding the medium intuitively, and they're the people that are going to be able to make the leap into taking it from a gimmick to creating something that just, you know, awes all of humanity, and then you can sell it around the world, and you can have $1 billion 360 productions. But you know, my mom today, I mean, is she gonna make the jump to 360? I mean, if she ever watches this video, maybe. I trust your mom. but you know, in thinking about that, you sort of have to go on faith that all the technological problems will get solved, right? Whatever they are, they'll fix them. You know, there's too much money, too much potential money. As soon as you say, oh, it's 100 billion in 5 years, there's a lot of people who are like, well, I only need 0.01% of that, and I'm happy. You know, so they'll solve all of that. You know, one of us will be the next Steven Spielberg, or you know, or something different. You know, maybe it'll be like Inception, where we just design dreams. We're all, you know, architects of the future. If I have another minute. I did a project in Istanbul before Christmas in November for Design New Turkey. And in that, what I did was scan the park in Milan using a photograph. Scan the park, and then we took this park in the virtual space to Istanbul. And then people in Istanbul could enter into the park in the VR space and then design over it, graffiti over it. They could recolor the trees, they could like, paint over the bicycles, you know, they could recreate the experience as they would want. You know, so maybe in the future, what we do is we don't make videos. You know, maybe we just architect, maybe we build places or build possibilities. You know, certainly you can imagine a future where, you know, you go to school to be an architect of a building that will never be built, right? That will never be real. Yeah, of course, it already exists. I mean, like, think of all the architects who never get to build it, but they can just simply upload it to the internet now and say, hey, you know, my library that no one would ever pay for, now you can go, and oh, by the way, there's actually books in it. You know, you can go into my library, there's actually knowledge in it. You know? So maybe that's the future of virtual reality. You know, maybe there's refugees all the time somewhere, and if you feel bad about your life, you can go there and you can feel better in this like weird, constructed, pseudo-journalist experience. You know, so who knows? And who knows what we will want? You know, there's that great scene in the movie Her where you know, he's home alone and he's like playing a video game on his couch. And that's sort of the future of augmented reality, right? You just sit there and somehow it's in front of you. You know, you don't have to turn around because, as you were saying, you know, it's not hours. You know, nobody really wants to lie in bed watching a movie and to like turn around on the pillow to see what's happening behind you, right? But you know, maybe you'll have a little guy that like, you know, beats you up and makes you feel bad about yourself hanging out in the living room. all the time, and you go home to him, and he's your virtual girlfriend, boyfriend type of situation. But maybe someone will build that. Maybe that will be somebody's vision of virtual reality.
But anyway, I think that for now, for people who want to do virtual reality, I talk with many friends and startups that are now involved in working on virtual reality. There are some fields which are interesting. For instance, a museum are very much interesting on virtual reality. So they are, and also something like installation for some reason, and this is very interesting also for what is the market. It's being used on marketing installation with virtual reality. Medicine, as I told before, the tourism and medicine, they are really much demanding at the moment for many reasons. There are some virtuality, for instance, for people who have cancer and they have to stay for 2 hours for chemotherapy. So they are making a different kind of virtual reality video. So for now, it's limited, of course, because I'm sure, I mean, you're very right in saying we are not the user, but we are the people who experiment and try to see the street. That's for sure, that's what we can do. And it is a fragment of little possibility to get some money to survive on this experimentation.
Sure.
And those are the things. And of course, as everybody said, the
to mention the live video.
A live video.
The live video is one huge.
Yeah.
Right now, a lot of companies are invested. A lot of investment goes to live streaming of music.
Yeah, and then, yes, because imagine, I mean, this kind of Milano with the best tenore, they do it only 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot call. And of course, they will be this idea be there at that moment, exactly the moment when this is happening, and be able to be 360, so to have the idea of being there, this idea of the reality, the truth, which is not the truth, you know, but it works in our brain. It's different truth. So.
I would have gone in Caroline, I will be very quick. I once talked with the person that's running UNICEF in Slovenia. They have a story about a girl in Syria. You watch the story through Gear VR, and using this technology, they were able to collect 4 to 5 times more money from the people now because they can experience the story. It's so immersive, I think this tells that this is showing that maybe this technology really, really helps you put there into that situation, and people get emotion out of the people, so the people are willing to donate 4 to 5 times more. So.
Yeah. Human rights, in fact, all the human rights festival now they have a section for virtual reality.
Also, a festival. Okay, thank you for coming, this fellow, I think, the guest here, and I hope it was interesting for you, and hope to have other dialogues like that in the future. Thank you.